right back to normal. The next item of business is a statement by Fergus Ewing on administration of Greensill Capital UK for businesses in Scotland. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Fergus Ewing. Cabinet Secretary, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My statement concerns the administration of Greensill Capital UK Limited and its implications for businesses in Scotland. I would emphasise at the outset that the subject matter concerns sensitive commercial affairs. Therefore, I will be careful in my remarks and in answers to members' questions to avoid saying anything that might breach commercial confidences or cause harm. I hope, too, that members might also recognise the sensitivity of this situation and the reasons for my caution. Greensill Capital is a UK-headquartered financial services company specialising in supply chain finance, working capital solutions and securitisation. Greensill Capital also has operations in the United States, Germany, Australia, Singapore, China, South Africa and the Middle East. The last full audited accounts of Greensill Capital UK for the year to 31st December 2019 shows revenues of $420 million and total assets of $682 million. More recently, the business has faced financial difficulties, and on 8 March, joint administrators from Grant Thornton were appointed to Greensill Capital UK. While Greensill Capital has no base in Scotland, the reverberations of the administration may still be felt here. At this stage, reliable information on the extent of Greensill's operations, the range of companies it financed, and the financial exposure of creditors remains unclear. A more substantive picture should emerge over the coming weeks as the administrators assess Greensill's state of affairs and prepare a statement of proposals for creditors. In the meantime, certain wider commercial repercussions of the Greensill administration have begun to surface. For example, it's clear that the Gupta family group of companies, known as the GFG Alliance, has been impacted. The GFG Alliance is a large multinational with over 35,000 employees operating from some 270 sites in 30 countries across the world. In Scotland, GFG owns several businesses through Liberty Steel Group, Alvance Aluminium Group, and Simec Energy Group. These groups operate the DL and Clydebridge Steelworks, the Lochaber Aluminium Smelter, the hydroelectric power station at Fort William, Jahama Highland Estates and Shand Cycles. Some of these businesses have received public sector support. Across other parts of the UK, the GFG Alliance is prominent in the steel, engineering and energy sectors. Liberty Steel UK, for example, is Britain's third largest steel producer and employs nearly 3,000 people at 11 sites across England, Scotland and Wales. I spoke with Sanjeev Gupta, Executive Chairman of the GFG Alliance, last Thursday. He was open about challenges posed by the collapse of Greensill, but also emphasised the underlying operational health of GFG's Scottish operations. He indicated that market demand is strong and metal prices are currently among the best seen in over a decade. Hence, GFG's Scottish steel and aluminium businesses are presently on a profitable footing, according to Mr. Gupta. Mr. Gupta told me the group has adequate funding for its current needs whilst they progress refinancing. He nevertheless confirmed that stabilising the finances of GFG Alliance in the near term is important to its future activities, including those in Scotland. On Monday, I spoke with the trade unions representing GFG workers in Scotland, GMB, Unite and Community. They expressed a very positive picture of the current strong markets in metals and the strategic value in retaining the skills and industrial capacity in these operations needed for the transition in Scotland to a low-carbon economy. Members of this Parliament, particularly those who have constituency interests, will want to be kept up to date, and rightly so. That's why I was keen to make this statement and take questions before the election recess. I will also undertake to update members further as required by circumstances throughout recess. But I can assure Parliament that officials are engaging regularly with the business at local and national level and through a ministerial task force, we are monitoring the situation closely. Today, I want to provide more information about GFG's footprint in Scotland, the public support, sector support that has been provided, and the economic return. Liberty Steel DL Limited is the recipient of a Scottish Investment Bank loan of £7 million. DL recommenced steel production in late 2016, having been mothballed by its previous owner, and the loan facility was agreed in March 2017. According to information from the business, at the end of 2020-21 financial year, Liberty Steel DL will have invested over £18 million in order to make DL operational and enhance its capability and product portfolio. In the 5 years since reopening in 2016, DL will have produced and sold over 300,000 tonnes of heavy plate steel. Sales to domestic and international markets have generated over £163 million in revenue. And perhaps most importantly, DL currently employs 140 workers, including three apprentices, retaining vital industrial skills and supporting livelihoods. In autumn 2016, the government intervened in support of continuing aluminium production in Lochaber. The Fort William smelter is of huge significance as the UK's last remaining smelter, with a current capacity to produce 48,000 tonnes of aluminium per year. The complex has been operational for over 90 years and remains a major source of employment in the West Highlands. In 2016, Scottish ministers sought Parliament's permission through the Finance and Constitution Committee to provide a guarantee of the smelter's power purchases. The committee reviewed and approved the contingent liability. Our support, which we offered to any bidder with plans for long-term industrial operations of the Lochaber businesses, prevented the breakup of the assets and closure of the smelter. The amounts guaranteed by the Scottish Government are published in the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts and vary between £14 and £32 million per annum over the 25-year life of the guarantee. Members may be interested in the economic return. According to information provided by the business, GFG has created 40 new jobs in Lochaber since 2016, raising total employment in the complex to 200 jobs currently. Payroll and pension contributions generated from this employment total over £41 million, and spending with suppliers, including many local businesses, exceeds £34 million since GFG's acquisition. These income flows are the very lifeblood that sustains communities and supports a large and valuable supply chain with hundreds of associated jobs. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, can I remind members of the sensitive commercial nature of the issues arising from the administration of Greensill Capital UK? The collapse of Greensill has clearly caused difficulties for a range of businesses, and we must tread carefully to avoid fueling harmful speculation. We in this government will continue to do everything in our power to support Scotland's steel and aluminium sectors and their highly skilled workers. Our actions will always be motivated by the desire to protect and create jobs, and to protect strategic industrial assets and foundational sectors on which additional supply chains and jobs rely. As ministers, we are accountable for the decisions we take, and I want to assure Parliament that where we have intervened, substantial due diligence was undertaken and appropriate measures put in place to protect and minimise the exposure of public funds. No industrial intervention is without risk, but I believe we have struck the right balance here. We have supported and enabled shorter and longer-term industrial and economic objectives. We are mitigating risks as far as we can. Critically, Presiding Officer, we kept Scotland's steel industry, kept our only aluminium sector open, and we are keeping people in skilled work.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in this statement. I'll allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we should move on to the next item of business. To be helpful to members, we press the request to speak buttons now if they were to ask a question, or press R on the chat function if they're remote. I call first Muir Fraser, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I welcome the statement that we've been calling for and thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of it. There has been considerable media speculation about the future of the GFG Group, given the financial issues affecting Greensill Capital and what this means for the enterprises in Scotland and in the rest of the United Kingdom. It is encouraging to hear from the Cabinet Secretary that the GFG Group believe the underlying businesses are viable. I would like to ask him what assurances can he give us, therefore, about the future of the workforces at DL and Clyde Bridge and in Fort William. And while he says Mr. Gupta believes the businesses are healthy, has the Scottish Government done anything themselves to get this independently verified, rather than just relying on his word that that is the case? Secondly, there are public monies at stake here. This government has a poor track record of investing public funds, if we look at Bifab, Ferguson Marine and Prestwick Airport. It has been suggested that the total guarantee from the Scottish Government is close to £600 million. Is that figure correct? And how does the Scottish Government assess the overall risk to public funds today in the event of a financial collapse of the GFG Group?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank Mr. Fraser for his question, and I can assure you that the continued operation of both the smelter and the steelworks are foremost in our objectives. And I made that absolutely clear when I met with the trade union representatives on Monday, and we had an extremely useful discussion. In that discussion, they shared with me their view that the workforce in both plants are optimistic. They are confident about the future ability of the plants to operate successfully. We have, of course, been advised that the plant at aluminium at Fort William, rather, the smelter, has been trading profitably. Mr. Fraser asks what independent analysis we do of that. We receive regular information which our officials share and discuss with our professional advisers, as Mr. Fraser would rightly expect. I do think that Mr. Fraser should be aware, because he was a member of the Finance and Constitution Committee that approved the guarantee, along with colleagues in his party and across other parties, as was right and proper, that he will agree that we did obtain to provide mitigation and protection against risk, appropriate securities, including a security over the plant, the smelter, the hydroelectric station. And I can confirm that these are very valuable assets, and the security value, although something that is commercially confidential, is very significant indeed. Presiding Officer, we took this action to avoid the loss of a steel industry and the loss of the only remaining aluminium smelter in Britain. If we hadn't acted, they would have closed.
Monica Lennon, followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement and welcome the engagement with trade unions, and I remind the Chamber that I am a member of Unite and the GMB. The collapse of Greensill Capital is raising concerns for jobs, businesses and public finances, not just here in Scotland but across the UK and beyond. The Cabinet Secretary said that the Scottish Government is mitigating risks as far as it can. I wonder if he could elaborate on the action that has been taken and whether there are any constraints or barriers to acting more fully. Like Murdo Fraser, I was wanting to hear a bit more about the verification of what Mr. Gupta has said about adequate funding for current needs. You know, beyond the strength of his word, what particular action has been taken to check out what he has said to the Minister? And given that the wide-ranging interests of the GFG Alliance and its close connections to Greensill, can the Cabinet Secretary outline what action the Government will take, not just to protect these jobs and vital industries in the short term, but much more importantly, for the longer term too?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President. I mean, I thank Monica Lennon for her question. She asks several questions, in fact. And I can say that the GFG Alliance are seeking to undertake a refinancing. This is a sensitive commercial matter, and we do need to be careful not to prejudice or undermine that process. We will do everything in our power to assist the steel and aluminium businesses and to support their highly skilled workers. And I stress that because, you know, one of the things that we did back in 2016 was the realisation that the workers were redundant in DL, and therefore we devised a special skills course where they reskilled and they were retained. They weren't lost to the steel plant. If we hadn't done that, we would not have been able to reopen that steel plant. The cost of that intervention was, I have here, I think, just under £200,000. So there are a number of interventions that we can consider taking. We will leave no stone unturned to do that job. And we will continue to work very closely with the trade union representatives, as we did in DL back in 2016, where we had 13 meetings of the task force which I chaired, which is a very large group, which actually included at that time one Richard Leonard, who was at that point a trade union representative. But we did work very well with no politics, focused on the objective of providing a future for the jobs in DL, and that we have done thus far, but we are not complacent, and therefore we are doing everything we possibly can to secure that future further.
And the usual mantra, and it's not directed at you, Mr. Rennie, but shorter questions, if I may, shorter answers. Willie Rennie, followed by John Finney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The government told us 5 years ago that the multiplier and supply chain impacts in Lochaber would be worth 2,000 jobs. Are we ever going to see those jobs? And what discussions did he have with Mr. Gupta about creating those jobs?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I ran over in my opening statement the answer to the number of jobs that have been provided. I think those are valuable. I hope the Liberal Democrats support that. They certainly do, I think, locally in Lochaber. I am pleased that we have received the safeguarding of 165 jobs, the creation of 44 new jobs at Lochaber. I'm pleased the company have assured us they've invested over £41 million in the business since taking over. And my understanding from their information is that that has included substantial investment in the value of the hydro assets and the further connection of the hydro assets to the national grid, thereby increasing the security value of the property. And of course, the problems facing the automotive sector meant that their original plans could not proceed. And that's simply a fact that nobody anticipated at 2016, not Mr. Rennie, not Mr. Mee, not me or anybody else, and COVID has intervened. However, the company have come forward with an amended plan which proposes a billets plant and a canning plant, and we are working with them, and indeed I was involved in chairing the Lochaber group that deals with the company on that matter. So there's challenges ahead, but we are working extremely hard with everybody in order to achieve delivery of these objectives.
John Finney, followed by Claire Adams.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the statement and indeed for the Scottish Government's active involvement in the smelter. I know that the Cabinet Secretary knows it well. Cabinet Secretary, you were involved in the launch of a PR about the plan, expansion plans. I think you're right to say it's important we don't have speculation. Are you able to talk about the status of that plan for the smelter at the moment, please?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not quite sure if I caught all of that, but I can say that the company's plans for expanding activities at Lochaber are in the public domain. I can share more information with Mr. Finney on that. And they include, rather than the automotive sector and the wheels factory, the billets market, which is broader, I think, and offers real opportunities for job creation. And also a canning plant, which would create some of the finest water for sale, Highland water for sale from Ben Nevis and the environs, and offers an exciting prospect. But the plans are detailed, the investment figures are clear, and I will endeavour to share that with members across the chamber.
Claire Adamson, followed by Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My grandfather spent most of his working life in the DL mill, so I know just how much it meant to have those jobs, and the production secured. Steel is synonymous with my constituency. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, while I know what it means to my constituents in Motherwell and Wishaw, what does the steel sector mean to Scotland's economy and Scotland's future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, you know, like Claire Adamson's family, many families in the centre of Scotland have the steel industry very close to their heart, and many people have seen their sons and indeed daughters work in the plant. And this is a story that we wish to continue, particularly as we explore low carbon opportunities. So the workers at the plant do, I believe, want this positive story to be told and for their hard work to be recognised. I'll just finish by paying tribute to the trade union representatives who assisted me in the task force back in 2016, including the inspirational Steve McCool, Ross Clark, Derek Fearon, Richard Leonard, Kenny Jordan and David Tarrant. And indeed, I had the pleasure of meeting up again with Ross Clark on Monday to thank him and the workforce for their great work for Scotland.
Jamie Harker-Johnson, followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to provide updates over the course of the coming recess. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, regards to the Fort William plant, when the plans were changed and announced, that the Cabinet Secretary gave his support and said support would be given by the Scottish Government. Can I ask, therefore, whether the Scottish Government has now reviewed the business plan for this facility, and if, in their view, the plans are credible, and given the level of public support for the facility, what assurances he has sought from the company over the plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
I was closely involved, as were my officials, in very detailed work when we renegotiated the original plan that was approved by the Finance Committee in order to alter the business plan, moving away from the model which was reliant on the automotive sector, for the reasons I've described earlier, towards more profitable opportunities. We also had professional advice on those plans before we ascribed our approval thereto. We had lengthy discussions and negotiations, which are commercial, about the basis of the alteration to plans, and we informed the Finance Committee of all of that work.
Rona Mackay, followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary why it was important that the support only go to a business with plans for long-term operations of the Le Gabber premises? And can I ask what has happened to those plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there was one clear reason why we took the approach that we did in offering support only to businesses for long-term, with plans for long-term operations of the Le Gabber businesses, including the smelter. And that was, if we hadn't done that, Presiding Officer, the outcome may have been that whereas the hydro asset would have found a purchaser, the smelter would not, and the last smelter in Britain would have shut. That was what motivated us then, and that's what motivates us now. And yes, the situation is challenging, but we are leaving no stone unturned to try to secure the future for the excellent workers at the Le Gabber plant, who are proud of what they do, who are trading profitably, who are providing an excellent return to the local economy, and of which is part of the local culture in Fort William and Le Gabber, very much so.
Rhoda Grant, followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to receive the reassurance with regard to GFG Alliance's operations in Scotland, especially in Le Gabber. When they purchased the Alcan Estate and Smelter in Le Gabber, a commitment was made to the Scottish Government and indeed the community that they would transfer some of the vast estate to community ownership, and this would have created more jobs and also boosted the local economy. I understand from East Le Gabber and Lager Community Trust that this has not happened. I therefore wrote to the Cabinet Secretary about this, but in his response he appeared to wash his hands of the matter. Therefore, can I prevail upon him to ensure that GFG Alliance make good their commitment to the community?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't think it's correct to say that I wash my hands of responsibility. I understand from the company that there were substantial discussions with community interests, including community councils, and that took place over a long period. There were also quite detailed discussions about one particular aspect of project which took place. There have also, I should say, been some substantial investments, I'm told, by the company in improving parts of the estate, the properties in the estate, supporting gamekeeping activities in the estate. So there has been investment in Jahama Estate that the company has advised us of, and I do recognise that there needs to be further discussion on all of these things, and of course looking at the potential community involvement is very much something that we would wish to encourage in taking things forward. Our primary focus, though, remains on preserving the plant and the jobs.
John Mason, followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much. The Cabinet Secretary in his statement mentioned the figures of £14 and £32 million as being the guarantee that was approved in 2016, including by the Finance Committee, which at the time I don't think I was on. Can he clarify, does that mean that the £32 million is the maximum guarantee that we would be liable for in any one year, or does it accumulate in some way so that there's a lot higher liability?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I did set out in my statement the information I thought it correct to share with Parliament, and the annual figure repayments do vary. The agreement that we reached and the guarantee that we granted was, as Mr. Mason says, one that was explained to and presented to the Finance Committee for their approval as a contingent liability. At that time, Scottish ministers had to present all proposals to grant guarantees in excess of £1 million. The committee received itself detailed written advice on the proposed guarantee. It had the opportunity to discuss it with me and senior officials before granting approval, and it did include representation, as I've said, from across the political spectrum, and as I understand it, the decision by the committee to approve the facility was unanimous. And that cross-party support was welcome then, and it will be welcome now, and I very much hope that we will continue to see this cross-party approach. It's certainly what the workforces want from us, Presiding Officer.
Edwin Mountain, followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest in the Diona fishery on the River Spey, which water from which river goes down to Loch Arbour to this plant. Cabinet Secretary, before the Scottish Government agreed to the annual revenues guarantee under the Loch Arbour guarantee, what due diligence did they do on the generating infrastructure of the plant, or did they just take the due diligence undertaken by Mr. Gupta?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, a whole range of due diligence was undertaken, as would be expected at the time of the original transaction, and that was conducted by employing leading firms and experts in relation to the various primary aspects that we had to check in this transaction. So I'm confident that we approached this and carried out due diligence as appropriate, Presiding Officer, and the Finance Committee, cross-party Finance Committee, played their scrutiny role, as rightly they were required to do, and they concluded every single member, every single party, to give support to the measure, and that was very satisfactory.
Kenneth Gibson, followed by David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as a former employee of British Steel for more than 4 years who actually worked at DL, I do have considerable concerns about the future of the industry. Is the Cabinet Secretary convinced that the steel industry does have a long-term future in Scotland, and that we are a prosperous one, and that the workers' jobs will indeed be there, not just for themselves, but hopefully for future generations?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, well, my ministerial colleagues have carried out work in respect of the long-term future of the steel industry, and the answer is yes, we do very much believe that there is such a long-term future, and I think I did allude to the fact that the market and the prices in steel are very satisfactory, higher than for some considerable time, and as we emerge from COVID, I think there is optimism within the sector. And therefore, the task facing us now is to overcome current challenges, because we do have the capacity to continue to trade on what we understand from the company is a profitable basis.
David Stewart, followed by Bob Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In his statement, the Cabinet Secretary made positive points about the Loch Arbour smelter, which I wholeheartedly endorse. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my view that the smelter is in good financial health, with a strong order book and new investment on stream? And finally, will the Cabinet Secretary do everything in his power to ensure that the smelter continues to be an active ingredient in Scotland's industrial strategy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I do. Yes, I will. I'm extremely grateful for Mr. Stewart's continued support, Presiding Officer. And could I just say, as I think this might be his last contribution, and as David Stewart and myself have known each other since, I think, 1990, when we first stood against each other, that his presence here will be sorely missed. I think he's one of a small band of politicians that has been both a councillor and MP and an MSP, over a long period of devoted service to constituents in the Highlands, and over all that period of over 3 decades of working with David, he and I have had an almost always constructive relationship. Almost invariably, he's pursued his campaigns with persistence, but always with courtesy, and he will be a sad loss to this Parliament, but I wish him, Linda, and his family very well.
And Bob Doris.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I'm aware that we're about to enter a period of parliamentary dissolution, but that said, what's the single most important thing we as members of this Parliament can do to help right now try and maintain these jobs and reassure worried workers and their families?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as one reads newspapers which are full of speculation, what one doesn't tend to see in those columns of comment is any consideration of the workforce. And what I really found from what really struck me from meeting with the trade union representatives on Monday is the sense of commitment and enthusiasm of the workforce to continue doing the great work they do, both in DL and in Fort William. So I think what the single most important thing we do is bear in mind that it is the workers who should be uppermost in our thoughts, the 200 at Lochaber, 140 at DL. And obviously, they deserve that we all act responsibly here.
Thank you. That concludes question and the statement. It's time to move on to the next item of business after a short pause.